Hello all, this is Gopi Padpudi. Today I am going to explain you all how to use a virtual based trigger framework. In the market there are several trigger frameworks available that are useful for our daily coding. One is like a virtual interface based and architectural based. But today I will show you how to use a virtual based trigger framework to implement all your triggers with a single line. So usually if we write a trigger, so we used to write a triggers like this. So yes, a trigger, and inside the trigger we used to call our trigger handlers with the help of if else statements, like it's a trigger dot is insert, is before, then call your trigger handler and then implement. If it is a trigger dot is after and is update, then after update trigger handler will be called and do the scenario. So the issue with this trigger is the code is going to be complex, and the later phase if you want to debug it is very hard. You don't know how many times the trigger is going to run even if you use the static boolean variable. So that's why we have a lot of trigger frameworks available in the market. I'm going to explain one of the framework developed by the Kevin. That framework I will explain you, and I will keep that framework in my GitHub also. You can freely download and use it. So let's see here. If you see my screen, I have written a trigger on the lead object. So to run, so I have added all the 7 trigger events, before insert to before update, and all the 7 events I have written. But I have written a single line of code, that is a trigger handler dot run method. So what it does and how it work, I will explain it. So before that, you have to make sure that there is a common trigger handler for any of your object, which is this one. So let's write you 100 triggers on 100 objects. So but this is the base class for your all triggers. Everything will run from this trigger handler only. So let's see how it is running and what are all methods are getting called and what is the important scope for this class. And the best feature of this one is that how you can bypass some of the classes. For example, if you insert some opportunities and it will insert some account records, so then it will call account triggers also. But you don't want to call the account trigger whenever the opportunity is inserted that drives the insertion of the accounts. So those things you can handle with the help of this trigger framework. And also you have like recursiveness also handled in this trigger framework by adding a simple line of code. So here I have added the trigger. This is our normal trigger, and I haven't added any trigger context here. So this line of code what I have selected will run 7 times based on the your trigger context. So if you insert a lead record, this line of code will call, and after insert, after update, before delete, after undelete, it will be called. But the context will be implemented in the trigger handler. So if you see my screen, I have like a methods written here, like before insert, before update, before delete, after insert, everything I have written here. So these are override. That means I have used the inheritance concept. I have extended the trigger handler so that the methods of the parent class I have implemented here, override here. So that is inheritance concept I have used. So when you go to the trigger handler, the methods will be just initialized, not at all so implemented. So it's like a protector virtual void methods are 7 are there. So whenever these methods implementation will happen in corresponding object trigger handler, whether it is a lead trigger, account trigger, whatever it is, or case trigger, or else attachment trigger, whatever it is. But the common class will be trigger handler is this. Let's see and so scope of flow and the line by line execution, how it is running by seeing the live examples also. So for now, I'm inserting one lead record. That time what will happen, this line of code will be executed, and then our lead trigger handler dot run will run. So when you see lead trigger handler, it is a class that inherits extends the trigger handler. So first the controller will go to the trigger handler, and then it will execute the constructor of that trigger handler. Before the constructor, actually static block of code will be executed. In my static block, I have initialized it to some of the set of strings and maps, but that I will explain that later. So here in the constructor, what I am doing is, in the constructor I am debugging trigger handler, constructor is running here, and the set trigger context I am calling. So why I am doing this, we don't know what context is running, so we have to first identify the context of the trigger, then only that particular method or piece of code should execute instead of executing everything. Okay, so currently I have inserted the lead record, the trigger context method will run. Let's see where this method is. So this is here, and it will check the if else conditions. So if the context is before insert or is after insert or is delete, before delete, after delete, such that the context will be set here. Okay, so imagine that your context is ready. The context is coming from the enum. Actually we have I have developed a enum property. In the enum I have all the 7 properties developed here. So I'm just Salesforce class controller will identify if the trigger dot context is before insert, then before update, or before insert, or after insert, after whatever it is, based on that the context will be assigned to this. Okay, once the context is assigned, what happens is, then our run method will be executed. Okay, the run method, will be available still on the trigger handler, the main base class. Okay, let's go to the run method. See, okay, so this is the run method. So inside the run method, what we are doing, some validation. This validation part I will explain you later. What it does is, suppose you are inserting a lead record, that lead record will insert one account record, but you don't want to call the triggers of the account record. That time you have to bypass the account handlers, right? So in that time this if condition will work, but for now skip that part and let's go to the line number 42 to the switch case. So we already assigned the this dot context value from the previous method, which was calling from the constructor of the our trigger handler. So in the trigger handler constructor, we are assigning the set dot trigger context. So now we know what is our trigger context. Then with the switch case, our class, our method will be called. For example, if it is this dot before insert, let's go to the before insert method. This is the before insert method, but it's not implemented. Then code will go to the implemented class. So in the before, here also I haven't implemented anything. So in before update also I haven't implemented anything. Then before delete also I haven't implemented, but I have implemented in the after insert. So the lead is inserted, that means successfully inserted, then the context will be after insert. Then it will come here and it will insert, try to insert one account record after printing one or two DMLs debug statements. Okay, but after account is inserted, what will happen usually? Account trigger will be called, right? We have a account trigger handy, so it will also have the same style of syntax. And in the account trigger handler I have implemented, right? So account is inserting means basically two events will happen, before insert and after insert. So I have printed those two statements, before insert and after insert, it should happen. That means with the by inserting lead record, we are inserting account and calling the account trigger functionality also. Okay, so that I will show you. And also, as I mentioned, seven method here. Whatever the functionality you want, you can implement that functionality here directly, and that will be derived from the trigger handler. So let's deploy. I already deployed this code. Let's check by creating one lead record. I'm just cloning it. I am just saving the record. Okay, then I will show you the line by line execution of where it is printing. Let's create again. Log got created, and we'll see the logs. If you see the log, first log is what lead trigger is running. Okay, so in our code where I have mentioned that lead trigger is running, so here, so lead trigger is running, and then what happens, it will go to lead trigger handler, but it won't directly execute the lead trigger handler. Lead trigger handler is implements extended the trigger handler. So trigger handlers, that means parent trigger handler, constructor and static blocks will be executed. Next line is like a trigger handler constructor is running. Obviously trigger handler constructor is running. What we have written in the trigger handler constructor? We have written trigger handler constructor is running, and we are calling set trigger context method. So then what happens? So trigger handler set context is running. Okay, then let's go to that method. So here also one debug statement is there. So what it is trying to do is whether it is a test context or a real life business context, it will identify with the help of this boolean test mode. Okay, if the test mode is false, that means it's a real time business scenario, and you set the trigger context is, it will give you the actual trigger context. Currently it is before inserting, so before underscore insert keyword will be written to the switch case that we have implemented here. So let's go to the that one. Then what is happening, trigger dot run is running, run method. So run method, why run method is running? Because in the set trigger context we are not calling the run method, but we are calling in the trigger handler. So okay, trigger. Okay, so let's go to the run method. Inside the run method, it will go to the switch case block. This is the run method, and it will go to the switch case. This dot before, this dot before update, that trigger based on the trigger context. So once this comes, it will directly come to the particular method and piece of code will be executed. That's how it is running. Let's see the logs. Yeah, so it came to before insert. Okay, in the before insert, what I have written, actually let's open control shift O lead trigger handler. Yeah, so in the before insert, what I have printed is the system.debug before insert is running, and the list of new values. So same thing as printed before insert is printed, and then lead record. Then again it will come back to the our trigger, because one event is finished. Next event is what, after insert. So again same piece of actions will happen, like it will go to the trigger handler to constructor, constructor to set trigger context to run method. Inside the run method, it will catch the after insert overridable method, and then it will come back to lead trigger, and then this piece of code will execute. Let's say this piece of code is printed here. Running and the lead trigger after insert. Okay, after insert is running, after insert, then what we are doing, we are inserting a account record. Okay, insert statement is there. So because of account insert, two events will fire, before insert of account, after insert of account. So say that's why in the debug log, so trigger.running is two times it is ran. Okay, so now I don't want to fire the account trigger. How I am sure that account is ran is, let's see this account trigger handler, what I have printed before insert, account trigger handler before insert I have printed. Push this code. Let's push this code. So I don't want to run the account and trigger events and trigger handlers. I just want to bypass them. Okay, currently we have to see whether they are getting called so that we can comment them later and see it. Okay, uncomment it. So let's come here, create a lead record, let's come to the debug, did you see here? Account insert before is printed here. Why? And also account insert after is also printed here. Why? Because in the code we have, in the account trigger we have printed the account trigger handler before insert, account trigger handler after. And these things are called because we have inserted a account record. Okay, but I don't want them to be called, then you have to bypass and you have to clear the bypass. So that time whatever the code you have implemented in the all the seven events, or else whatever, oh, for now you are inserting, so those two events will not be fired. Okay, let's deploy this chain and create a new record from the lead object. And our expectation is account should not be called. So currently in the line, you see here line here, the blue color one, account is called and account handler is called before insert and after insert, because we haven't bypassed the trigger. So it's successfully deployed. Let's create a lead record. Go to the debug statement. See, I don't see any account trigger handler is printed here. Okay, because it is bypassed. How it is bypassed is, let me show you. In the trigger handler, before running the method, I told you that we have like a validate run, this valid run will check that this valid run will check whether the particular account handler needs to be considered or not. Let's go to this valid run and see how what code is written here. So in the valid run, what I am doing is I am returning the bypass handler that contains our handler. So bypass handler is a set of strings, and whether it is containing our account handler or trigger handler. Okay, then this calls the get handler name. Get handler name will give you the name of the handler name, whatever it is. You can bypass anything by adding, for example, in the lead trigger, I have added like lead trigger dot bypass account trigger handler. You can bypass opportunity trigger handler, case trigger handler, or contact trigger handler, whatever the trigger handler you want to bypass. That means you do not want to run because of this before. If you don't add, if you think the triggers might fire, then in that scenario you have to add the bypass. Okay, here this bypass bin, if it is contains, then it will return the true statement. If it is true, then run statement will exit, because see, return means nothing after this. No line of code will be executed. Validate run means our handler is in the bypass set, so don't execute anything. That's how it works. And I just want to tell you one more thing, like how this instance will be returned, right? So if you see get instance, get handler name, handler means class name. So we have a like string dot value of this nothing but currently which class is running. Let me uncomment this and show you easily. I need to deploy this. And also, if you see substring 0 to index of colon, that value we are returning, and then we are checking the content statements. Okay, and before that, where we are adding dot add, you have a doubt, right? So trigger handler dot bypass handler dot, because in our trigger handler we are adding like trigger handler dot bypass method. So in the trigger handler dot bypass method, we are passing the class name, and then this will call the bypass handler dot add. Okay, and when you go to the bypass handler, let's go to the bypass handler. So bypass handler dot contains this get instance name. So get instance, I want to deploy this and show you how the class is coming. Let me show you. And it will take the substring from 0 to colon. It's deployed it. Let's clone it again and check it. So if you see string dot value of, we are printing in our debug statement, right? String dot value of and this means current instance. So if you see, and we are taking a substring of 0 to semicolon, so what is the value? If you see, only this is the data. Whatever I have highlighted is the string that we are fetching from the entire handler name. Okay, so if this value will be added by the lead trigger here. So we are adding the lead trigger handler, trigger handler dot bypass dot adding with this string. And when this actual context comes, and we are checking that one. Hey, this is already there, so don't run the code. This is how we bypass. Unbypass means we will remove the data. So let's go to clear. If you go to the clear bypass, in the clear bypass, I am removing the name. So since you remove the name, when you run validate, okay, is valid. So this if condition will return true, and negation of true is false, so rest of the code will be executed. This is how we have to implement the trigger framework with a single line of code instead of using our legacy style of writing if this dot trigger dot insert and is insert is after something like that. So I hope this video is very helpful to you, and I have kept my code inside my GitHub. I will place this link in the description. You can access this, and also you can refer Kevin O'Hara also. This link also I will provide if needed. Thank you so much.